our August 16th City Commission meeting, let us stand and say the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Can we have our roll call, please?
Mayor Hines.
Here.
Commissioner Martin.
Here.
Commissioner Vogt.
Here.
Commissioner Wilson.
Here.
Commissioner Terry.
Here. Okay, and before we move to the proclamation on our agenda, are there any announcements this evening?
Good evening, Jim Hemmert, Boone Street, Pickwell, Ohio. And I would like to make a few award presentations this evening on behalf of Bike Pickwell and Bike to Work Week. And
Jim,
would you like, yes?
We have that as a presentation in two items.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So is there any announcement you'd like to make?
No.
You'll be making the presentation in
I'll announce that I'm going back to my place.
But you'll know the way to come back when it's time, so. All right. Oh.
Mine's not redundant. Jeff Lang, 9586 North State Route 66. I know there is a reading tonight on ODOT and approved bike trail for 25A and 36, but the Pickwell multi-use bike path, pedestrian path, running path, whatever you want to call it, is 12 separated miles of different paths along which cyclists, pedestrians can get to anything they like, which is very important. Of course, you know, Pickwell's 12 miles is connected to 330 miles and is the nation's largest paved trail network. And just because we used our brand new counter behind the municipal building here, we have recorded over 18,000 pedestrians and cyclists on the Pickwell Trail system for the months of May, June, and July. That's an average of about 205 per day, which is phenomenal. $10 to $13 million in annual economic benefit to the Miami Valley from the regional trail system, and that is great compared to an average annual expense of about $1 million STP funds expenditure for the whole regional trail system maintenance. So the trail is phenomenal. I'm glad Pickwell has it. I use it almost daily for exercise and to get to wherever I'm going, for businesses, services, and just seeing attractions. So thank you, Pickwell, for supporting the trail, and I'm glad we have it. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, and now we have a proclamation in honor of our former mayor, commissioner, and city employee, Mr. James Henderson. And I know some of his family is here tonight, so I'd like to invite you forward and join me at the podium. We have a proclamation. Whereas Mr. James Henderson served the city of Pickwell as Pickwell City Commissioner from 1976 through 1979 and served as mayor from 1978 to 1979. And whereas not only was Jim a dedicated commissioner and mayor, he also served the city in another important role. And whereas the citizens of Pickwell benefited daily as Mr. Henderson served the city in the capacity as street superintendent from March 22, 1985 through November 30, 1999. And whereas it is important that we understand the duties, responsibilities, and sacrifices Jim made during his career as mayor, commissioner, and street superintendent while serving our city. And whereas the city of Pickwell would like to offer our condolences to the family of James Henderson as he passed away on June 28, 2016. And we would like to thank his family for his service for the city of Pickwell. Now therefore, I, Catherine B. Hines, mayor of the city of Pickwell, do hereby proclaim Wednesday, August 17, 2016, as James Henderson Day in the city of Pickwell. In witness thereof, I have hereunto set my hand and caused it to be affixed the seal of the city of Piqua, Ohio, the 16th day of August 2016. And I know that Commissioner Vogt also would like to say a few words.
You know, 13 years ago, I went down and saw Jim in his garage, and I said, I think I'm going to run for city commissioner. He says, are you sure you want to do that? But he guided me through it. I got elected. After I was elected, Frank Patrizio and I was elected together, and we sort of upset the political machine at the time. And information coming from the city manager's office was very sparse to us. Frank had his dad, who was a former city manager, and he was an attorney. I was a tool and die maker. And Jim guided me through that, told me the questions to ask. And if there's anything coming up, I always talked to him. And he never told me how to vote, but he told me where to look. And I really respected his tutelage to me for at least 2 years. And that is not enough for Jim. Thank you.
And now I'd like to invite Jim Hemmert to come forward with our Silver Petal Awards.
Once again, I'm Jim Hemmert from Boone Street, Piqua, Ohio. President of an organization called Bike Piqua. This is our fourth year presenting the Silver Petal Award. The Silver Petal Award is given for people using their bicycles during Bike to Work Week. We have four awards, a small business, a large business, an individual, and a school. And at this time, if the small business, Mr. Artie Parker, would you step forward, please? You would ask that question. Artie wants to know where I got the pedals.
They look good.
He happened to have a few left over. Artie Parker is this year's small business recipient. Artie Parker, during the Bike to Work Week, he rode 127 miles. He burnt 6,900 calories, and he saved 150. Didn't show. Mark just told me it doesn't show. And he saved $115 in gas and contributed toward clean air. So at this time, Art, I sure would like to present to you.
Isn't that nice? Thanks.
Yes, sir. Mark Spoltman. Grace the carpets. Sure. Mark Spoltman is here representing Hartzell Propeller. Hartzell Propeller is our large business award recipient this year. They happen to have ridden 430 miles. They burnt 23,000 calories, and they saved $387 in gasoline. So with that, Mark, and by the way, this has been used a lot. Look at that.
Yeah, I can tell.
Thank you so much for your contribution.
And thank you.
They came from France, too.
France?
Yes. Georgia Hertenstein from Piqua Catholic Schools. Between Georgia and her athletic director, Pam Kennedy, who is now in Florida, Ohio. this was their first real entry. And they, in turn, rode 1,100 miles, their students did. They burnt 60,000 calories, and they saved over $1,000 worth of gasoline and contributed to clean air. So Georgia, on behalf of Bike Pickwell, once again, congratulations and thank you for your contribution to Bike Pickwell and Bike to Work. Just a couple more sentences. On behalf of Bike Pickwell, I would like to acknowledge the schools, the mall, downtown merchants, Beppo Uno's, YMCA, McDonald's East for providing bicycle parking at their places of business. And if you happen to go by any of those places, hopefully you will see bicycles. I see them at Beppo Uno's and at the Y almost daily. Cycling has become a alternate means of transportation for short trips around town, to pay bills, to buy a stamp, to just get some good exercise. Cycling is a good exercise. It provides clean air. It is healthy. And the city of Piqua is a contributor. As Jeff told you, with 13 miles of paved path in Piqua, 205 people a day using our path, 6,000 people in 3 months using our path. It is a viable, beneficial asset to the city of Piqua, and Bike Piqua indeed does thank you for your contribution and listening to us. Thank you.
And now we move to the consent agenda portion of our meeting.
The consent agenda consists of the August 2nd regular city commission meeting.
I move we approve the consent agenda.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, our consent agenda has been approved. Now we move to old business, and the first being ordinance number 11-16.
An ordinance to levy special assessments to pay for the cost of nuisance abatement assessment.
Ms. Welker will provide the staff report.
Thank you. Each year, the city abates nuisance conditions on properties consisting of things like mowing grass, trimming trees, picking up trash, things like that. And each year, we present these abatements to you to approve to put on the property taxes per our ordinance. How this occurs is we receive complaints about properties. A lot of them are vacant. We then do an inspection. The property owner is notified that the condition exists and is given time to comply with the order. If they fail to do so, the city then hires contractors to abate the condition, and then the billing gets charged back to the property owner. If they fail to pay that cost, then the city has the option of placing that on the property taxes. So this ordinance puts that into place so that we can try to collect those costs.
Thank you. Any questions from the commission? This is our third reading of this ordinance. Do we have any questions or comments from the public on this ordinance?
I move we adopt ordinance 11-16.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Let's have a roll call vote, please.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Okay, ordinance number 11-16 passes. And now we move on to our new business, the first being resolution number R-95-16.
A resolution of support for the development of state and U.S. bicycle routes.
I'll call on Mr. Schmeising for the staff report.
Good evening. Thank you. The item you have before you is by way of a request from the Ohio Department of Transportation. The ODOT Bicycle Programming Administrator is working on a project in Ohio, along with their colleagues from the other districts, that would designate certain routes as state bike routes. This is in conjunction with the larger effort at the national level to designate national bike routes, or U.S. bike routes. So there's coordination happening between the states and the Adventure Cycling Association. It was really the organization that kind of led the effort to get this conversation started. They recognize that there's a good number of folks who are taking adventure cycling trips across state lines and multiple states, if you will. And they saw a need to have a good mapping system that would actually designate the proper routes for those folks to be traveling. While we have a pretty phenomenal, if not world-class, I might say, trail system in the Southwest Ohio area, there are spots where those trails stop. They're anticipated to go further east, west, north, or south, but those connections aren't there yet in terms of a separated path. So in the interim, what ODOT plans to do is designate the proper routes on the roadways to complete those state route connections and or national U.S. route connections. Because these pass through a variety of jurisdictions, they would like for the local entity to pass a resolution indicating your support for this project. And as a result of that, once they have those resolutions of support, they'll go about the business of signing the routes. Once the signs are up, the sign maintenance would become the responsibility of the local jurisdiction. Nothing else involved in terms of transfer of responsibility or cost. The roadway would continue to be maintained just the way it always has been by the responsible party. This is simply the installation of signs and the formal designation of these U.S. and state bike routes so that they can be mapped and published and shared with the world. Questions?
Okay.
Yeah, are they going to mark the streets and roads, Chris, for, with basically a bicycle lane?
Well, in yes, but not in Piqua, because all of the state route 36 bike route through Piqua is a separated trail. So there's no, they would only be marking in those areas where there's no trail that currently exists. So like from Piqua to Covington or Covington to Greenville, where there's no trail that's off of the roadway, they'd sign that portion of a roadway that they think is the appropriate route to connect you from Piqua's trail to Greenville's trail.
Okay.
So in Piqua, U.S. Route 25 bike trail and the State Route 36 bike trail, they're already separated facilities and they're off the roadways. So there really isn't much of a signage need in Piqua proper.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome.
Any other questions or comments from the commission? All right, do we have any questions or comments from the public on this resolution?
I move to adopt resolution R-95-16.
Second. Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay, resolution number R-95-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-96-16.
A resolution to approve the form and authorize the execution of a power sales contract with American Municipal Power Incorporated and taking other actions in connection therewith regarding participation in the AMP Solar Project 2.
Mr. Krager will provide the staff report.
Thank you. I'm here tonight to talk about and recommend participation in the AMP Solar Project Phase 2. This project and potential power supply resource for the city of Piqua has been vetted through several stages already. As we always do, we moved this through the Piqua Energy Board in June, and the Energy Board recommended commission approval and moved forward. And then in July, we brought this information to the city commission at a work session as well. As we do and always have in the past with potential power supply resources, because they're very, very important part of our business. Power supply represents 75 to 80% of the power system's cost, and so these decisions have to be analyzed and both from a fit within the city of Piqua's needs and as well as the economics of that. We employed Don Grudenmeyer and Solvent Associates, and we've been working with those folks now for an excess of 20 years, and they were at both those first two steps of the recommendation process. So I'm going to move through a few slides here and give some background information, and then also move through and kind of show how it fits it within our needs, and then ultimately detail our recommendation. So as a reminder, you know, years ago we generated all our power here, and then unfortunately the plant was shut down in 98 as a result of changing environmental regulations. For some period of time, we purchased the majority of our power from the market, and then in about the 2007 time frame is when you know, the economy was doing well and power prices were going up. We're getting lots of complaints from customers about the cost of the power. So as part of our membership in American Municipal Power, PICWA, along with a number of the other members, there's 130 some members in AMP now, decided to move and take control of their future in terms of power supply costs. And you can see what's happened over those years. And you know, previously when the plant was shut down, the only resource that we had that remained was an allocation from the New York Power Authority, two large hydro projects up near the Niagara Falls area. It represents a pretty small portion of our supply. We've had that since the 80s, but then the resources that we, this commission and the city decided to move into in 2007 started to come online in 2012 with the Prairie State Energy Campus in Lively Grove, Illinois, which represents the newest and the cleanest coal plant in the country. The AMP Fremont Energy Center is a combined cycle natural gas facility near up north on your way to Sandusky. It's been a very economic resource for us with natural gas prices being what they've been the last few years. And then the renewable portions of our portfolio include a purchase power agreement with a Blue Creek wind project in Van Wert and Paulding counties, and then the hydro run-of-the-river hydro projects on the Ohio River, Meldaw Greenup, which are both online now, and then the AMP hydro project, which is the Willow Island, Cannelton, and Smithland projects, and the only project that remains to be completed is Smithland, and it'll be completed later this year. So the majority of these resources are online, and they're doing exactly what we decided we needed to do, is build a power supply portfolio that's diverse. It's got a number of different energy sources, some carbon-free and some with less carbon than others, and mitigate exposure to the volatile market prices, which is why we decided to move into resources, and then provide long-term price stability, which is exactly what this has done. This pie chart represents a depiction of these resources. Prairie State at 47% of our supply, Fremont gas, natural gas at 17%, and then the renewable resources, the Blue Creek Wind Project at 4%, the New York Power Authority Hydro at 3%, Meldaw Greenup Hydro at 3%, and then the AMP Hydro Project at 9%. And this is when all the projects are online at the end of this year. We'll still have 17% of our need that's being fulfilled from the market. So as a summary, long-term resources represent approximately 79%, with 19% of that being renewable with the mixture that I just talked about. And then this project that we're going to discuss tonight is the AMP Solar Project, another renewable carbon-free peaking resource that, if we were able to get our full allocation, we would it would represent 3.5% of our supply, and take our renewable piece to 22.5%. As a brief description of what this project is, because of the benefit of the tax credits that can be secured for these projects, AMP partnered up with a subsidiary of Florida Power and Light, which is NextEra. They developed project, which is DG, Distributed Generation AMP Solar. And this project is a number of solar sites that are being built behind members' meters, and there's up to 26 sites have been identified, and there's still the opportunity to add additional sites with a capacity up to 80 megawatts total. And by participating in this project, it also gives us the ability to potentially host a site, and the possibility for PIC would be anywhere in the 1 to 3 megawatt size scale, which is a pretty nice size solar project. As far as costs, this is another beauty of this project. It because it's solar and it's because it's behind the meter, a large portion of your cost is the cost to move the power from the resources to the customer, which is the transmission. And then capacity is really just the iron behind the energy that's being purchased. The PGM RTO, the Regional Transmission Organization we operate in, requires that you have capacity for the energy you buy. So by participating in the AMP Solar Phase 2 project, you get the transmission benefit reduction and the capacity reduction. And there's also a market right now for these solar RECs, and they're going to add value to the project as well. So the estimated cost of the project, when you deduct off the solar RECs, the transmission elimination of the transmission costs, because it's effectively behind the meter, and the capacity benefits, is $35 a megawatt hour, which our all-in power supply costs for the city of Pickwa now is in the $60 to $65 range, so that it's almost half of what we're paying for our all-in supply right now. And what we're comparing this to is really a market energy, which is a peak day market. It's not just the, you know, the middle of the night. This resource generates when the sun's out, when it's hot. Over the last few weeks, when we've had these unbearably hot and humid days, you know, the sun's out and these solar projects are generating, unlike some other renewable resources that don't necessarily generate when you're on your peak. So you're reducing the most expensive power, you're displacing the most expensive power that you can purchase. And you know, this projection that Solvo provided, the total cost of the market on those peak days, when you add in the transmission and capacity, which you would need to move that energy, would be in excess of $100 a megawatt hour. And this finally is a load duration curve, and it's just meant to kind of depict when you look at the hours during the day and the load on the left and Pickwa's peak, where does this solar fit in? It's a peaking resource, so it's at the top of the curve, which again is typically the most expensive power that you purchase. You know, our base load bottom needs are being built with or fulfilled with the plants that run all the time, such as Prairie State, and then the what they call the intermediate needs is met with our Fremont natural gas combined cycle plant, because it runs Monday through Friday, you know, 16 hours a day. They call 5 by 16, but again, you need to fill those peak hours, and we do it currently with our gas turbines, but you know, we don't have enough capacity, and the cost to run those is fairly expensive. In terms of total power supply cost, this project itself, by displacing market purchases, would save approximately $500,000 per year, which equates to about 0.14 cents per kilowatt hour. So, and finally, the recommendation that we brought before the board and then discussed at the commission work session was a maximum subscription of 6,725 kW, which would fit our peaking needs. So it provides us some resource diversity to go along with our combustion turbines, but it also allows us for room for participation in future resources. If you remember right now, we're, I think, 17% on the market, so even with the 3.5%, we would still have in excess of 10% of need should other more favorable or better fitting projects come up in the future.
Okay, that's it. Thank you. Any questions from the commission?
Yeah. Ed, where in here or the AMPS contract does it give us a hard price that says you're going to pay this?
There are no hard prices on any of the power supply that we purchase. Every resource that we have, if you look at our power bills, made up of 7 to 8 line items. There are fixed costs, like our debt service costs, fixed costs that are variable costs, but there's a number of items that are in there that are congestion, transmission, you know, all these items that are added together. So again, there's items that are fixed, which are also, it's going to be the prepaid debt service, the cost per energy within there, but then there's the projections for transmission and capacity savings, as well as solar RECs, which is again where the recommendation and the evaluation that Don completed is estimating that the cost will be below $40.
It's estimated.
It is estimated. It's at half our power supply cost today. So it could be less, it could be more. When we entered into the Fremont Energy Project, the estimated price of power from the Fremont project was in excess of $40. We're paying $20 today.
Okay.
So there's fixed components, there's variable components, and like any of these projects, we evaluate them, we use the experts to help us evaluate them, and we pull all the data that we can pull together, and we make a good educated decision. And this is a great project. This will represent the second lowest cost resource in our portfolio behind New York Power Authority hydropower.
If it stays at $35 and doesn't go up.
I mean,
there's already a chance it's going to go to 49 $49.78 or something like that if it doesn't, if all of our stuff doesn't come in line.
You just said there's a chance it goes to 40-something, which, again, our all-in power supply cost is $65 now.
Okay.
So that reduces our overall power supply cost. There's also a chance it could come in cheaper if transmission costs are more expensive, if capacity costs are more expensive.
Okay, how come AMP can't give us a solid price when the other two people that did contracts with them that bid on theirs said it would be like $52.50 per megawatt hour or $72 per megawatt hour? How come AMP can't do that?
We can't do that for any of our projects, but as far as the third-party building in Beckwa, we don't have a guaranteed site, so I can't guarantee we'll build a site. The nice thing about working with this AMP project is we get the benefits of the diversity and the renewable resource, but we also get the option in the future to build a project if we can secure the land. If we don't secure the land in Beckwa and we go to a third-party provider that is more expensive than even what this program is, there's no guarantee we get it built.
Those other two estimates that AMP got, that wasn't for them to put a solar field in every place they're going to sell power.
You talking about the Solville study was based on, that was, Solville did that, AMP did not do that. They did that on behalf of the Western Area Service Group. We provided them six potential sites in the Western AMP Service Group.
No, I'm talking about the ones that AMP asked for them to, when they was doing the whole solar thing, they wanted to bid it out to see what it would cost to see, so they have a benchmark.
That wasn't AMP. That was the Solville study that the Western AMP Service Group asked them to do, because we were being contacted by a number of these third-party developers. And so we wanted to make sure that we were bringing the best program that we could to each of our individual communities. So that's why we asked Solville to evaluate these third-party programs. AMP had nothing to do with that. That was Solville's evaluation. And we put a site out there that actually is not a valid site anymore. We were looking at the potential site over at Pickle Materials, and we found out it was in the flood zone. That was one of the sites that was being evaluated. So the six sites are not AMP sites.
If those two companies that Solville got the estimates from could give us a firm price, how come the AMP's contract doesn't have a firm price in it?
It's a whole different animal, John. It's not an apples-to-apples comparison. And again, we can't even...
How is it not an apples-to-apples comparison? It's X amount of megawatts. How much do you pay for it?
I did my best I could to explain the situation. It's the way we buy every resource we have. We decide to move into this diversified supply of resources. This is a great fit within what we have. It builds upon our carbon-free resources. It's guaranteed to be below the cost of what we're paying all-in power supply today. At 30-some dollars, even if there's some fluctuation above or even below, which is a potential as well, it's going to reduce our overall cost. And which is what we're always looking to do for our customers, because this is a huge part of their customer's bill. Power supply represents 75 to 85% of our costs. So
yeah,
we take these decisions very seriously.
Now that you told me that we couldn't get the ground, this is a question. I was just wondering why we was only doing 1,740 megawatts of solar when we're going to buy seven. Why wouldn't we do almost seven? But that comes down to the whole land thing.
This whole AMP program, the biggest project's being built in Bowling Green. It's a 20 megawatt site, and unfortunately, they're taking a good portion of that. So I think it'll be very hard for us to get our full allocation. What usually happens is in a project like this, it's oversubscribed, and then we got scaled down in Fremont. We wanted more Fremont, and we got less. And I think that's what will happen here, because finding good solar sites is not easy to come by. It's got to be a property that's economical. It's typically well fields. It's typically, properties that are not being used for other reasons. So, but I hope to be able to build a project in Pickwa, but this is the first step.
Okay, and an AMPS contract in the Solville paperwork, it says that to not get in over 6,725 kilowatts. How come in the AMP contract it says we're requesting up to 7,970 kilowatts?
If you notice in the resolution, I changed the amount in the resolution. So that was an earlier version of the contract.
So the contract that I was given isn't the right one?
that number may need to change, but the resolution has the value in there. I changed the resolution to match the amount. AMP typically on projects, and they've done this on every project, they'll come up with their recommendation based on the LIDAS study and the needs assessment they do for every members, because some of the small members don't use an independent consultant like Solville like we do. But then we take it an extra step and pick one of the members of the WSG, utilize Solville to really, I think, take the starting number and do a refinement of it, and that's why it was scaled down slightly. So, but the resolution that we're being asked to approve tonight has that the amount that matches the Solville study in it. So we'll make the correction in the contract as well, but we're not executing the contract tonight. We're just asking for approval of the resolution. Is that a problem, Stacy?
You weren't given an incorrect copy of the contract. It's the only copy we have at this point. And until the resolution is approved, we haven't gone back to AMP to make any edits to the contract.
Okay, so does that mean that we re-vote on this contract when the contract's right?
No, the meat of the contract is in the resolution. So the resolution indicates its approval in substantial form of the contract, which you've seen. So like Mr. Krieger was explaining, we're just changing the amount that we would be requesting or purchasing. I've already reviewed the contract. There's nothing else in there that I am requesting changes to.
Now, in the force majeure part of the contract, From the way it reads to me, if an airplane was to fall out of the air and land on the solar power the array, we would still have to pay for that every month.
It's pretty standard language in every contract you have. When there's a force majeure incident, the contractor's not responsible for that incident, whether it be a tornado or anything like that. That's very standard language.
So is this a take-and-pay contract or a take-or-pay contract?
No,
it's a take-and-pay contract. The power, we buy the power as it's generated.
This contract's actually very different than the other contracts we've entered into where we're paying when we get the energy, whereas the other contracts were not like that.
The nice thing about this one project is there's no construction risk. We don't start taking power and paying for power until the project's commercial, I think 5 days after commercial. Whereas the hydros, you know, and Prairie State and all the projects we built, they're take or pay. You still have to pay the debt service.
Well, it shows us starting to pay in 2017. Will all these be done in the next couple months?
No, the numbers change as the projects come online. The Bowling Green project is the first project. It's the biggest. It's going to be the most economic. And then there's a number of other projects. Each project gets assessed by NextEra, DG Solar, to the economic. They do an economic valuation. If it fits within the economic criteria, then they move forward. If it's more expensive because maybe it's too small, maybe it has some construction issues or whatever, then they come to AMP and they explain that could increase the cost. So as each project is completed, then it gets added to the total project. So again, my hope would be we could develop project and pick, but initially we would start taking power with Bowling Green and all the other projects that are online, and potentially our project would come on later.
Okay, now just grant me some leeway on my numbers. So that means that like in October, we may be able to get 100 kilowatts. And then 2 months later, we may be able to get 1,000. And as these come online and it grows bigger, then we would finally get to the 6725?
Yeah, and we may never get there
if
the project's oversubscribed. But yeah, in essence, as projects are done, we get our allocation. And then say it doubles, then we get twice that amount. And then, so our percentage allocation of the project will be defined when the subscription period ends, which I believe is November 1st. And the Bowling Green project is supposed to be completed by year end. So my guess is that we will start taking power from this project potentially in December, probably no later in January.
Okay, and why is it that we're going to get power for 25 years, roughly, but the contract to pay for power is for 30 years?
There's actually two options in the contract. There's a 25 and a 30-year. It depends on ultimately how the project's financed. If they secure 25-year financing, it'll be a 25-year project. The agreement with NextEra goes beyond because something has to happen to those assets at the end of the 25 years. Say they still have value, maybe we want to purchase them. Maybe AMP wants to purchase them. So that's what that mechanism is the agreement with NextEra is beyond the 25 or 30-year life, depending on how long the project's financed. Because something has to happen to the assets at the end of the term. Maybe we purchase them, maybe AMP buys them back. Maybe they're
okay, but if we're not getting power from them, we're not paying a power bill.
No, there will be no. At the end of 25 years, if we don't want anything to do with this project, we're done. Or 30 years if they finance it over 30. It depends on what the term is. But based on the financing costs and the really extremely competitive interest rates, they're pretty strong feeling it's going to be a 25-year term.
Yeah, because I'm thinking that some of the information is 4% was the number.
Again, when they go to finance, and we've had this with Meldall Green up just recently, the numbers come in better, and then the cost of the power is better. So.
Okay.
Anything else? Anything from the public on this resolution?
I move to adopt resolution R-96-16.
Second.
Okay, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Okay, and resolution number R-96-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-97-16.
A resolution establishing trick-or-treat beggar's night in the city of Piqua.
Yes, each year the Miami County Council establishes the date for trick-or-treating or beggar's night. This year they have proclaimed October 31st will be the date from 6 to 8 p.m. They do request all the municipalities in the county adopt this date by resolution so that everyone is doing it at the same time. So that would be Monday, October the 31st. That is actually Halloween.
Okay. Any questions about this from the commission? Any questions or comments from the public?
I move we adopt resolution R-97-16.
Second.
Okay, we have a move and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, resolution number R-97-16 passes, and trick-or-treat will be October 31st here in the city of Piqua. So mark your calendar now for that event. And now we move on to resolution number R-98-16.
A resolution requesting authorization to amend the bidding phase of the contract with Strand Associates for additional expenses incurred during that phase of the new Central Zone Water Tower project.
Yes, I'm going to call on Mr. Jennings to provide the staff report. I just want to make one comment that the next few items that you're going to hear are related to a loan that we're working on and would provide us with the opportunity for funding for this project, very low interest. And so these items are related to this. One of the things that Mr. Jennings is talking about is a capability assurance plan that must be completed in order for us to get the loan. So I'll let Mr. Jennings share that information.
Thank you. Yeah, back in June of 2013, we started working with Strand Associates to engineer and design the water tower for our central zone. And of course, they've done that. The plans have been approved by the EPA. And then back on April 5th, we passed resolution R-47-16, which moved Strand into the phase where we could go out for bids for the project. During the time of that, we found there was a lot more work than we had anticipated on our loan. Mr. Huff mentioned for the capability assurance plan, and Strand did a lot of legwork with us on that to do that work. So because of that, our cost for that phase has increased, and we're asking to increase the resolution by $13,000. Just to give you a little background, all municipalities that go for these low interest loans that the Ohio EPA make available are required to do a capability assurance plan, and all that does, it just shows that you're managing your system correctly, that you have the proper financial backing to cover the loan and so forth. There's quite a bit of information that they require, both from the treatment process of the plant, your accounting for your water loss, your finances. There's a lot that they have to handle as well. The list is 2 pages long of the information they require. So there is a lot of work that goes into that, getting it all together.
And it is important that we have the expertise putting this together to ensure we get the loan. So
exactly. And Strand did, you know, great work with us and the finance department as well to get all this together so that we could get the loan approved.
Okay. Thank you. Any questions or comments from the commission? Any questions or comments from the public? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Move to adopt resolution
R-98-16.
Second. Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, resolution number R-98-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-99-16.
A resolution authorizing the city manager to apply for, accept, and enter into the Ohio Water Supply Revolving Loan Account Agreement on behalf of the City of Piqua for construction of the Central Zone Tower Project, including the Drake Road Waterline Extension, and designating a dedicated repayment source for the loan.
Ms. Holtz-Apple will provide the staff report.
Thank you. As Bob indicated, the Central Zone Water Tower Project includes a water line extension on Drake Road, a 1 million gallon composite water tower, and the demolition of the two small downtown towers, as well as design and construction administration, the application fee for the loan, and project interest during construction. All of these, along with contingencies, are estimated to be approximately $4.44 million. The city has been awarded approximately 24% or a $1.075 million Ohio Public Works Commission grant that will help offset a portion of this project. This legislation before you tonight will allow the city to apply for and enter into a loan agreement for an Ohio Water Supply Revolving Loan throughout that fund for the remaining $3.365 million. The loan rates for this project are set monthly and range from 1.4% up to 2.56% with a term of 20 to 30 years. That rate and the term will be determined once the application has been reviewed at the recommendation of the Ohio EPA and review and approval by the Ohio Water Development Authority. Also, the next four resolutions, resolutions 100-16 through 103-16, are to grant preliminary consent to award contracts for the project. These two are necessary for the loan application, and Bob Jennings will present and explain those in further detail. Your approval for all resolutions tonight will allow the loan application to be submitted this month. Once the loan is approved, we will come back to you for approval to award the actual contracts. This is very similar to the water plant project and loan. However, we are applying under Ohio EPA, which is a lower interest rate program that we're hoping to acquire for this project.
Thank you. Any questions from the commission? Any questions or comments from the public on this resolution?
I move we approve resolution R-99-16.
Okay, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Okay, resolution number R-99-16 passes, and now we move on to resolution number R-100-16.
A resolution for preliminary consent to award a contract to Chicago Bridge and Iron Company for the new Central Water Tower project.
Mr. Jennings.
Yes, thank you. We received four bids for this project. We opened the bids on July 25th. Chicago Bridge and Iron was the low bidder, best and low bidder. Their bid was $2.921 million. The engineer's estimate for the project was actually $3.2 million. So we did come under the engineer's estimate, which was good. Strand Associates has worked with Chicago Bridge and Iron before. They're a reputable tower company, you know, that does construction. They do many towers. And then we did add a 13% interest onto this. And as was stated, this is just a preliminary consent so we can go for the loan. It is also mentioned that it is a composite tower. It will have a concrete base and a steel bull. And it, this part of the project also includes the demolition of the two existing towers, the one on South Main Street by the old power plant, and also the one on Spring Street along the river.
Will the new water tower have an enclosed bottom?
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions or comments from the commission? Any questions or comments from the public?
Move to adopt resolution R-100-16.
Second.
Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Okay, resolution number R-100-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-101-16.
A resolution for preliminary consent to award a contract to GM Pipeline Incorporated for the Drake Road Water Main Extension as part of the new Central Water Tower project.
Mr. Jennings.
Yes, this portion of the project will go to tie the existing distribution system in with the new tower. So in order to do that, we have to run a new 12-inch water main down Drake Road. And then once it reaches our easement that we have along Mr. Sherry's property, the water main will then go along there to tie into the new water tower. And then it'll come from the new tower and tie into the system on Fox Drive as well. So that'll complete our loop on that south end, which we will now no longer have basically a dead end at the south end that we currently have now. So that'll help our whole process greatly. We received 9 bids for this portion of the project, which was, you know, really good actually. And the engineer's estimate was $1.2 million. GM Pipeline was the best and low bidder, and they came in at just over $642,000. So almost half of what the engineer's estimate was. And we did have even a couple bids that were pretty competitive to that one. So we did some research on GM Pipeline, as well as Strand Associates looked into them, and we have found no reason not to award them the contract for this portion of the project.
Okay, thank you. Any questions or comments from the commission?
Yeah, well, setting this up this way, will this also help us with our trihalomethane problem?
Yeah, and actually it goes back, I forgot to mention, in the new water tower, we are also putting a removal system as we put in the Ash Street Tower. If you remember when we redid the tower, we put a removal system in that. This tower will have the exact same removal system in it. And we did a study, since we've had that system in the Ash Street Tower, we were guaranteed a 40% reduction of disinfection byproducts in the tower with that system. And during our study, we actually found that we were reducing almost 70% with that system on. So it definitely does work, and the new tower will have the exact same system in it. So not only with looping the distribution system that way, but also with that system in the tower, it will greatly reduce that as well. So we're really in need of it, and I think we'll see a big difference with that in there.
Okay.
The way it works now, that water from that town has to, most of the time is coming from our R.M. Davis tank, and by the time, you know, it gets to that in a town, the life of that water has been in the system a pretty long time, and this will keep things a lot more fresh at that end of the town. So.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments?
These prices that are quoted for all these contracts, they will still be in force when we are ready to go ahead with them, with the contract, after
yes.
we get the loan approved?
That's correct, yes.
Okay.
We just can't award the contract until the loan is approved.
Right. Mm-hmm. I understand that.
Okay. Any questions or comments from the public on this resolution?
I move we approve resolution R-101-16.
Second.
Okay, can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Okay, resolution number R-101-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-102-16.
A resolution for preliminary consent to award a contract to Strand Associates for the construction administration and resident project representation for the Drake Road Water Main Extension as part of the new Central Water Tower project.
Yes, we'll give the contract to Strand Associates to monitor the entire project. They will also have a project representative on site to make sure that the construction goes, you know, as plans. And then it also gives them the administration rights for the project.
Okay, thank you. Any questions or comments?
In all these projects, the neighbors will be notified whether they're in or out of this city, correct? With so many feet of the construction or?
Right, yeah.
Okay, so if they have any questions.
Exactly, yeah.
Okay. Any questions or comments from the public on this resolution?
Move to adopt resolution number R-102-16.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Okay, resolution number R-102-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-103-16.
A resolution for preliminary consent to award a contract to Strand Associates for the construction administration and resident project representation for the new Central Water Tower project.
This goes just along with the other. Along with the Drake Road Water Main project, we have to have a administration and a resident project representation also for the water tower. So this just will award a contract to Strand to handle that portion of the project as well.
Okay. Strand calling, yeah.
Must be. All right, any questions or comments from the commission?
Yeah, we're paying them over $250,000 to do this for us. Is there any way that we can do it cheaper?
We really don't have the staff or the to have construction expertise for these projects is really necessary. Otherwise, you're going to end up with a problem. So we really don't have the staff to do that.
Right.
And that's why it's important to have a consultant that has that ability to be out there all the time watching every move on the construction part.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Anything else? Any questions or comments from the public?
I move to adopt resolution R-103-16.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Could we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Okay, resolution number R-103-16 passes. And now we move on to resolution number R-104-16.
A resolution authorizing a professional services agreement with PROS Consulting Incorporated for a comprehensive parks master plan.
Mr. Smeezy. Thank you once again. In the 2016 budget, we included funds to be able to complete a comprehensive parks master plan. The proposals that we received back were all very good. We had solicited several consultants for a proposal. We received five, interviewed four of those consultants, and the selection committee determined that PROS Consulting would provide us with the best product if hired. PROS proposal for this project is $74,940, and the services they would provide would include a very extensive amount of public engagement as part of the comprehensive planning process that they would undertake, in addition to online survey and other survey work where they would engage citizens and stakeholders in the community to find out what their preferences, wants, and interests are. There would be a statistically valid survey so they could verify that the information that's being provided is indeed accurate and correct, consistent with what the needs and wants really are. And then the consultant would go through that process of looking at our existing park system,
both the land and the facilities and the programming, the operation and maintenance of such, and evaluating our policies and our lease agreements with other entities and so on and so forth, to really make sure that we're meeting the expectations of the community. And at the end of the day, the document would provide us with a 10-year vision with the detailed information that's needed to be able to understand what those expenditures might look like for future improvements and or enhancements to park spaces and that sort of thing, along with helping to identify funding sources for those type of improvements. So if this legislation is approved, PROS Consulting is prepared to begin work almost immediately. They're ready to go by the 1st of September. They're very excited to do the project for us. We have some experience with PROS. They were a sub-consultant on the Historic East Piqua effort, so we're familiar with their firm. We did check references. They've done work with for a variety of agencies in the area, including Five Rivers Metro Park and some others, and all speak very, very highly of PROS Consulting. I believe City Manager Huff is also familiar with PROS from previous employment. So we're very comfortable with moving forward with PROS and would ask for your authorization to enter into this contract so that we can begin this process. All total, the comprehensive planning process is expected to take about 9 months to complete.
Let me add that we've never done a comprehensive parks master plan, and it really needs to be done because to determine what types of facilities need to be developed in what parks and where in parks, to have those master plans of the parks to be able to, as we get funding and as we get people wanting to do projects or donate projects, to know where they should go and the appropriate places for them. There may be parks we need to get rid of. There may be parks that we need to move. There may be new parks that we need in places that we have not identified yet with those opportunities. So this is an important part of really looking forward and being able to meet the recreational needs of our community. So I think it's an important step for us to take in our overall planning process.
Now, does this also help us on some grants that if you maybe did not have a master plan, you might not have the same chance as if you had one?
Absolutely. If you have a clear and defined vision and understanding of what it is you're trying to accomplish when you go to apply for those funds, it certainly helps to have that kind of resource document to back up what you're asking for.
And I can tell you from experience that if you're applying for land and water conservation fund, that you've got to have a master plan to go by. So they require that you submit that with the applications.
Well, and I have to say, having served on the park board for quite a few years, this is necessary and it's timely. Yeah. It is very timely to have this. So I think it's
much needed.
It's much needed, isn't it?
And our facilities are to the point where it's very evident that it's time to take a look, see at things, and figure out where we go.
Improvements that need to be done. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Was the park board involved in this?
The park board will be very involved in this. I'm sure there's been some discussion at some point earlier in the year about the fact that there was money appropriated in the budget to be able to do this. Now that we're embarking on the process, we'll re-engage with the Parks Board.
John, I believe that's in their strategic plan.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, that we adopted 3-4 years ago.
I was going to say it was on, yes.
Yeah.
And that, I'm saying that's the Park Board strategic plan. So.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I'm looking at this report and it talks about the public engagement process. So there's going to be meetings in the beginning that the public are going to be invited to give their input.
Beginning, middle, end. The public engagement piece is something that we've kind of developed a reputation in PICWA as very much wanting and requiring that of our consultants. So when we interview consultants now, they see some of the other projects that we've completed, and they immediately understand that public engagement is absolutely necessary and something that we really value and want, and you have to do it correctly. So at the beginning of the project, there'll be engagement in terms of, you know, this is the time to dream a little bit and kind of think about big things and what you might want that's not here that you've seen elsewhere. And then as those ideas are tested with the surveys, we'll see, you know, what rises to the top. And then, you know, there's a process of looking at the cost of all those things and determining which ones are the priorities. And that gets you closer to the end of the process where you're actually sitting down and saying, okay, this is really where we want to go with this. All throughout that process, we'll keep touching base with those stakeholders and citizens to make sure they're a part of the discussion. And that's the way you do it. That's the only way to do it correctly.
I think usually the citizens enjoy being asked to participate and give their opinions.
And it's essential to do it correctly. Like I say, it's these are the recreational amenities serving the needs and interests of the citizens. So without their input, you're really you're doing it a disservice if you're not engaging them in the conversation.
So if we, what this plan would do would be say list a priority list of things that we think we need based on the input, and then once we identify that, it would also help identify where it should go or where it shouldn't go, and then possibly funding sources and a way to get there. Is that kind of the way
correct.
It's going to work, something like that?
Yeah, you'll actually see a master plan for each park.
Right.
Yeah.
But it may be that, okay, so each park would have a defined set of
what should go
capital here. Things for each park, and okay.
There'll be a menu at the end of the day that says, for this park, here's the anticipated improvements, and here's the cost, and here's some resources, and here's the timeline.
And then would each item have a priority list? So the top priority for all the parks would be this. The second priority for all the parks would be this.
Yeah, again, through that survey and engagement process, we'll be able to vet out those requests and those wants and needs to determine which ones will serve the greatest number of citizens relative to the one how many people ask for it.
So
it'll help
park
you prioritize
would
those.
Be prioritized with whatever items. So we would know this park has number three, this one has number one.
Mm-hmm.
Thing.
Certainly helps with budgeting purposes,
right.
too. So.
Okay.
It'll give you the data to make informed decisions.
And where, and when and where we apply for grants.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Any questions or comments from the public on this resolution?
I'll move to adopt resolution R-104-16.
Second.
Okay. Can we have a roll call vote, please?
Commissioner Wilson?
Aye.
Mayor Hines?
Aye.
Commissioner Terry?
Aye.
Commissioner Vogt?
Aye.
Commissioner Martin?
Aye.
Okay, resolution number R-104-16 passes. And now we move to the public comment portion of our meeting.
Just if you want to speak, come to the podium. Mm-hmm.
My name's Ron Old Emmerich. Do I state where I live? Or mm-hmm. I live on the corner of Broadway and Water Street, 200 Broadway. I have contacted, first of all, I've contacted the department about that's responsible for street signs, for a one-way street sign to put up where I live. Mm-hmm. Is it the one area down at where it meets High Street, there's two signs saying do not enter, and there's no signage stating that it's the one. I'm sorry, I'm nervous.
You're okay.
I apologize.
You're fine.
I'm trying to be calm. But anyway, the way I live at, I mean, I got a little spot to park, but there's people that come up that street all the time. And for a long time, it used to be marked as a one-way street. And like I said, I contacted the appropriate department to begin with, and then also contacted the city manager office, and there's still no sign. I don't know why. I don't understand why it's not marked.
Are you saying that the one-way street sign is not there?
No, there ain't one at all.
Pardon?
There's not one at all.
Okay.
But at the other end of the block, it's got do not enter signs. You got people that come out of the alley, the office that down there, in the old funeral home, this little area, people that live there. I don't know. Every now and then, you got people coming up the wrong, going out the wrong way. And fortunately, I haven't had no accidents, but you know, eventually, I just don't want to see nothing happen either.
Okay. I will assure you, we'll be out there tomorrow to check the signage and everything. I don't know that I've heard that was an issue, but I can assure you now that you've said something, we'll have somebody out there tomorrow.
I'm trying to address this in an appropriate way. You can verify with your city manager that I did contact her about it by phone and in person. And, you know, I don't know, the supervisors just go out and look at it, but I feel that it's necessary for the Sonic to be put up.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I'm the city manager, so I'll be happy to go out and we'll have somebody out there to take a look at it. So.
Okay. Yeah. Well, maybe I did talk to you, but I talked to your...
You talked to someone. Okay, sure.
She's sitting right there.
Okay.
I hope you don't mind.
Beg your pardon?
I hope you don't mind that
I gave it to someone, and I'm not sure where it's at. But
that's okay.
The city manager will check on it for you.
But I did address that with you. And also, at the same time, there's another thing I addressed to her as well, was there's a piece of property where there was a house you guys tore down. It's spent down, but you guys maintain it, but it's not being maintained appropriately. And about a month or so, sometime last month, there was an article addressing the drainages be cleaned up, and and that's not being done for that property, and the trimming's not being done right either.
Okay.
So I'm trying to do this correctly here. This is my first time being here.
Well, we'll certainly take a look and see.
All right, thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Emmerich, is that property on Water Street that you're speaking about?
Water and Broadway, yes.
Right across from Tim Hortons, kind of?
It's the triangle property there.
The triangle property.
Yeah, okay. It's right there in the corner of Broadway, and it's at an angle. And I don't know if the people realize that the property line runs all the way down Broadway. Mm-hmm. I know they mow it, but they don't go out and trim it up.
Okay.
They clean it up, they blow it off. And that was addressed in the article that's posted. I'm sorry, I'm trying to be...
You're fine.
I'm trying to be clear about what I'm saying and be, try to be appropriate about it. And I'm not trying to point fingers, but I also care about things.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to show my,
Sure.
And we appreciate that, and that's one of the gifts of good citizens is to have eyes and ears for us in some places, which is exactly what you've done. So thank you very much.
And then right there on the corner of where I do live at, Liette owns it, and there's weeds and everything growing around there. Drainages. I've cleaned it up last year, but that's really not my spot to do.
Okay.
So that's all I have. I hope I'm not out of line.
No.
That's very appropriate. Thank you very much.